Hello, my friends, so cuando los maníes son un montón de ideas. Please welcome to this tutorial. We are not sure that this topic was covered in previous research, but we are sure that this is the first tutorial on that. So this is about machine learning supported groundwater model calibration with Python, Modflow, PySal, and scikit-learn. Okay, so on previous tutorials, we have done a tutorial where that has regional flow, rivers and lakes, three layers and three piezometers, okay, located at different layers. So the piezometers are located at different layers. Okay, so then we have run SALIP, that is a sensibility analysis, okay, in order to define, well, that was on the previous tutorial. No, webinar, okay. However, what we have here, okay, so and this is really long to be done. This is really long to be coded, okay. So this is just a review of the, this is just a review of the different steps. Okay. So, and I hope that we can make some, I hope that I can create some classes, and as well as I create some classes, I mean the Python classes, and then I can give a webinar on course on that and then apply this methodology, because it's actually really powerful when you want when you want to calibrate more complex models, okay? So and actually I'm looking for open study, so in an open case where you where we have a static model, so you can send me an email, so saulmontoya@hatarilabs.com, okay, or through LinkedIn, and then give me the link, and then we can apply this in but in a more real scenario. Okay, so what we copy the original folder where we have a function. Actually, FlowPy used to work, I don't know why, but cannot change the directory. So I have created a function that do a complete copy of the model, and plus with modification on the mfsim file. What else I have? Here I have here we have a function that actually copy the original folder and create some changes the parameter based on what we have on our on the final parameters, or the parameters based as parameters of the function, okay, and returns the piezometric data. Okay, this is the, we run this for one parameter, okay, and then we create a testing. Okay, this testing, okay, this is a testing that actually will divide the sum intervals of the parameters, I mean of what you think you know about the parameters, the range of what you think you know about the parameters, and it will divide in it will divide the interval, okay, based on here is 20, so we get, I guess, 320 samples, okay. However, this could be an iterative step. So what does it mean that it could be an iterative step? That based on the results, okay, so you are going to see two sets of results. Based on the results, and you have to go back and then try to narrow some parameters, okay, especially the most sensible ones, okay. So then we have a box plot, okay. I'm not going to run the sensibility analysis here. Why? Because it actually takes, for this model, it takes maybe 2 minutes, okay? For larger model, that could That could take days, but even that, there is a concept of the it's just computing time. I mean, for anybody that has done model calibration, this is really a painful task. Although we have to be very sure about how we are calibrating our model, we have to be really sure about how we calibrate and the responsibility, because actually, and please take this off your mind, the computer won't calibrate for you. I mean, you give tools that the computer get the best match, but it is always encouraged that you have the control of that, okay? Great, so I say it, and it has to be said, and then I say, okay, so this is a box plot of the variation of the log. Actually, we won't work with the parameter, but the log of the parameter. Why? Because we have to avoid negative value. Actually, you don't have a negative hydraulic conductivity, so if you work with the log, you don't have that. And as well, the sampling algorithm runs better. Okay, so we have oops, actually here is running, so I will stop it because it will take some time. Okay, and then here we have the okay, well, actually, and this, yeah, I'm sorry, I have to run, so I'm going to pause and then I come back once it's run. Okay, great, so that actually took 2 minutes. Okay, so we have an array, actually this is salib, and this is results from the salib library. Okay, and then we got this beautiful graph where we see that based on the ranges and based on the model is actually, for example, the piezometer tree, for example, in this case, the piezometer tree, which is the piezometer tree, this is piezometer tree. Okay. Oh, sorry. No. No. Oh, sorry. This is piezometer tree. Yeah, this is piezo tree. Piezo 3 is more dependent, okay, on the river conductance, and that's true, and of K of lay 2, okay, while piezometer 1 is more dependent on K of lay 2, on K of lay 1, and on river conductance and on regional conductance, okay, because piezometer 1 is this one, okay. Is this one, okay. And the piezo, this is piezo 2 that is in the middle, it is more sensible to K of layer 2. What is more sensible to K of layer 2? Because it's really low. I mean, if K of layer 2 actually change of because it's defined as a low permeability aquifer, okay, low conductivity aquifer. Because it change, actually, it will change the whole hydrological behavior, okay? And also to the conductance of the boundary conditions, okay? So as we see, only in piezo 3, the recharge value, and for example, in this case, we have negative sensitivity, so this is actually detached. So it says that it's actually, or like, I understand that it's actually detached, so actually it doesn't matter what it will be. They won't change the values of piezo 3, okay? So, but this is going, is this just going to create this text array and log param values, okay? So here you have the text array and log param values, okay? And in this case, this is used to create a multilayer perceptron regression, okay? So here, this is the multilayer perceptron. Yeah, so we do some scaling of the values, but they actually, because this is on the log scale, so actually was pretty easy to scale, okay? And I have just scaled the input data, so the x, so the param values, no, the I have scaled the heads, and I will use the heads in order to simulate the param values, okay? So, okay, this actually runs pretty fast. So, and this we will open because we have two cases. Okay, so we have two cases. TXT, JSON, then here we have one case, and this case has a parameter of hydraulic parameters and also what it will be the observed values, and this is the other case that it will be case 2. Okay, so if we run this for the case 1, we get the predicted parameters. Okay, so this is actually the parameters that were calculated from the machine learning. So actually you gave the heads and it provides you the parameters based on all what we have done. Okay, so if we want to compare it, so here, yeah, we open the param values and then we get the predicted piece of data, and this is the observation data. Okay, and this beautiful code, actually what it does is runs with the predicted params, okay, and compare to the observed params, and it gives you some the root mean error. This is the head, the normalized root mean error that we are really in a low percentage. Okay, really really low, so actually the fit is quite good. Okay, however, if I run this for the second set of parameters, so actually this is for case 2 and this is case 2. Okay, so I will run it for the second set of parameters. The second set, okay, because okay, I will create the predicted params for the second set, okay, because otherwise I cannot run it. Okay, and now I'm going to run this, restart. Okay, so here the error it's greater. Okay, however, and I will tell you that, for example, we can narrow some things, like based on experience, you need more water here. Okay, so maybe in the neural network, the amount of the values of recharge has to be on a shorter range. Okay, and maybe also you have to decrease your hydraulic conductivity, so you actually the top of your hydraulic conductivity ranges has to be shorter as well. Okay, so but okay, just to get 8% of the first of an RMS, yeah, it's not so bad. Okay, in this case, okay, but if you are working with the case 1, actually it's perfect. Okay, so this is perfect. Yeah, so that will be it. I usually do not do this, but I will, as I told you, this is my email, so I'm interested in having a conversation about to run this, but in a normal model, a steady state model, and to see which is the challenge, to have this in an open steady state model to run this and to see how this works, and it will be posted in another tutorials and so on. Okay, so yeah, that's it. If you are doing, I remember my first calibration, so this is actually quite disrupting. So if you are doing your calibration, take a look on this and take a chance to run, to explore the code, though this will, and this is be responsible, because the groundwater calibration is the most important, is one of the most important parts, not only of the hydrological modeling, but it is a key part where you have where you are going to take decisions from your numerical model. So if you have a model that is not well calibrated, or like it has some magic inside, this is a tool that will help you, okay, and it will give you more, it will give you a much information about how your model is working and how you can do that it matches better the observed values. However, and I told you, be responsible, this is not a washing machine. This is not a washing machine where you put your clothes, the water and the detergent, and then you will have your clothes washed, okay? So you have to give some feedback, and then you have to analyze what is going on. You have to review the water balance and so on, okay? That's it. Thank you for following us, and hope to see you in coming tutorial. It was a pleasure to give you this. I took, supposedly it was going to take me half a day, and actually it took me 2 hours, 2 days and a half, but I think, yeah, it looks good. Okay, bye bye and have a great day. And all the scripts, it will be on the description of the video.